Okay.
So, as I told some of you, maybe not everybody was here, I graded period one quizzes in it. That took all morning, so I didn't have time to grade all of yours as well. But there are some things that I'm going to assume are problems that, that you two and all three of my algebra 2 classes have in common. So we're going to talk about those. So hopefully you're the kind of person that if you're not quite catching on to the slope-intercept thing and you are forgetting, oh, is this the intercept part, is that on the x-axis or the y-axis? When I do the slope, is it, how do I do it? If you're feeling that confusion, then you're making yourself plot points instead of guessing at how to do slope-intercept, okay? Because when you concentrate on how to do something and what the process is and your memory, you're relying on a weak form of your ability to learn. You have far more capable than your ability to remember things, okay? So if we don't remember how to do slope intercept, well, it's still a graph, right? We've talked about what a graph is almost ad nauseum to the point that it makes us sick, right? Hopefully we're getting it, we understand it, and even if you didn't do it the way that I'm talking about right now, you know what a graph is and what it takes. So if we're not sure how to do that, then what do we do? What do we do if we're kind of feeling like we don't really remember slope-intercept and how to graph things that way? The answer today is the same as the answer from the beginning of this section when I had that big blue screen up there with three questions. What's a graph? What does the point represent?
A graph is like a collection of data in points.
Stay away from the word data, because data implies the messiness.
It's like a chart organizing x and y intercepts.
Okay.
It's essentially the points of a function.
The points. And each point represents what?
An x and y, so an input and output in a function.
Yeah. Okay. So an input and an output, or these two numbers, when you plug them back into that equation, the equation is equal. It's true. Okay. So if you don't remember how to do slope-intercept, you're finding points. Okay. Whenever I saw somebody who found points, rather than just doing it the fast way, the shortcut way, the slope-intercept way, putting a point on the y-axis and following the slope, I was much happier to see someone who put points rather than doing slope-intercept slightly wrong. See what I'm saying? So like if you got the rise and the run switched, or you went up three into the right one, you should have gone up three into the left one, or anything like that. Well, the reason you got it wrong is because you are relying on your memory and you forgot how to do it correctly. But if you plotted some points and you got the points wrong, well, that's just down to like computation. I didn't multiply the fractions together correctly, or I did 3 plus 2 is 1 because I accidentally threw minus 2, right? I made little mistakes like that. They're easily fixable. Whereas if you're relying on your memory now and you're not remembering it correctly, you try to build on that, that's a faulty foundation. Let's build on the foundation of I know a graph is a bunch of points and I know how to find those points by finding input and output, okay? So if that's making sense, great. If it's not, let's talk about it for a second. Let's do a quick example. So let's have our notes out. Take some notes on some discussion points about the quiz that I'd like to go over. So let's say that you grade on the slope-intercept form and you do it right every time. You're going to do it like this. You're going to come down on the y-axis 5. That's what we call our y-intercept. Okay, we'll talk about why that is in just a second. And then I follow my slope. It's up 3, 1, 2, 3, and over 7, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and over 7. Up 3 and over 7, and there we go. If I'm graphing a line, personally, that's what I'm doing, right? I never make mistakes when I graph lines. I've been doing it too long to make mistakes. And that's the fastest way that I can think to graph a line. Go to the y-intercept, follow the slope, and I'm done, okay? But if you ever do make mistakes, if you are not completely clear about why this works, then you should not be using, you shouldn't be using things you don't understand if there's the opportunity to understand it. So say I don't know the slope-intercept thing, I can't remember, like, I keep finding myself putting this, what should be on the y-axis, on the x-axis, and I'm flipping the rise and the run, and I'm getting things backwards, and I'm having trouble. Then I just need to find 2 points, right, because I know it's going to be a line. Because that's, well, at the very least, that's what we're talking about. I can tell you now, and have been telling you for a while, all the graphs we're graphing right now, at this time, on this quiz, and on the test that will come at the end of this unit, are all lines, guaranteed. So at least you know it's a line. You know you need 2 points for a line. You find 2 points, you can connect them and make your line. So again, if I'm struggling with slope-intercept form, I just need some points. Let's go back to plugging in things for x and getting things out for y, and we want to pick things that are easy to plug in for x, starting with what's the easiest thing? Zero, even better than one, zero. Plug in 0 for x, 3/7 times 0 is 0. 0 minus 5 is negative 5. Oh, okay, that's why that lone number that's hanging off there by itself, b, right, plus b, that number is the y-intercept, because if I plug in 0 for x, that's all that will be left, right? That's what I will get for y. So that's why there's a point on the y-axis right here, because I plug in 0 for x and that's what I get. Okay, now for the y of over 7 and up 5, or up 5 and over 7, however you want to think about it. What's the next easiest thing to plug in for x? 7. If you don't know why, we'll find out right now. Plug in 7 for x, then your life will be much easier than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6, or 8, or 9, or 10, or 11, or 12, or 13. 14 would be good. And here's why. 3/7 times 7. I like to, if I have a fraction and I'm dealing with like a non-fraction, I like to put it over 1 and make sure everything lines up. Well, however you want to look at it, cross-cancel the 7s and you're left with 3, or 21 over 7, 21 divided by 7 is 3, whatever you want, however you want to look at it, we wind up with 3 minus 5. Why do we plug in 7? Because it cancels this denominator of 7, because it makes this number be divisible by 7. So that whenever we take whatever divided by 7, we'll get a whole number, right? Why do we do it? Because we don't have to deal with fractions, common denominators, and all that kind of stuff. If we put anything else like 2 or 3 or 4, well, we're going to have to take 3/7 times 4, have 12/7. Now we're going to have to subtract 5 from that. That means we need to find common denominator. That's 35/7. And now we're having to find common denominators and deal with all that. Okay. So that's the reason behind the slope, because we want to go over to x's 7, because that's the next number that's going to land the point right on the grid. Not on a fraction, not on a decimal, not in between, but right on the grid. And that would be the easiest thing to graph. And if you look on your quiz, there are little dots, right, already there, right on the grid, right at the meeting place of two whole numbers. That would be the easiest way to graph these things. So we plug in 7, we get out, -2. Look at that, that's exactly what you get. That's the point that you find when you follow the slope over 7 up 5, or up 5 over 7. Okay. Every time we go over another 7, or what am I doing? Up, sorry, not up 5, but up 3. Because okay. Every time I go over another 7, another 7, another 7, I just keep going up another 3, up another 3, up another 3. Do it. If you're not seeing that pattern, just keep doing 14, 21, 28, 35. Just keep going through the multiples of 7 until you start to see that every time I go up another 7 in the x's, my y just goes up 3 from the previous one. I'm going to go up 3, go up 3, go up 3, I'm going to go up 3. I bet you if you do the math on all these, that's what you're going to get. It's not magic. It's not something you need to remember and memorize. It's just a shortcut that we noticed and we're just going to take advantage of, because we understand the math behind it. Any questions there? we move forward and we're trying to, I'm trying to build on top of your foundation, and that regardless of where you are right now, that's what we're going to be doing. We're going to build on the foundation you have right now. If it's good, and I understand that a graph is a bunch of points, and I understand how to find those points, and you know, make it a little easier on myself, I understand the shortcut as well, then that's a good foundation. If I only ever paid attention to the shortcuts, and I'm not remembering the shortcut correctly, I have so little understanding of what a graph is, of what it means to draw this graph, of what these points mean, all that meaning is lost. If I just rely on remembering the shortcuts. And if I try to build on that foundation, it's gonna be very shaky, really fast. Okay, so, if in doubt, always plot some more points. Plot more points until you have an aha moment and say, oh, I see what he's saying. Every time I put in the next multiple of 7 for x, then I just get the next multiple of 3 to add on. -5, and so that just has the pattern of go up 7, up 3. Okay. Any questions about graphing ones? I know you don't have your quizzes in front of you, which I wish you did, but just don't have them for you right now. Any questions about graphing? Okay. Here's something that I saw. Some people, 2x plus 3 minus 4x equals 2 minus 5x plus 3. Let's make sure. Okay. Well, the first thing that I want to point out that wasn't too much of trouble for a lot of people, but some people were doing this. What we should be doing here is distribute this negative into the parentheses. That's what we should do. Some of us are still doing, we talked about this before, is distributing this 2. I shouldn't distribute this 2. This 2 is not multiplied by the parentheses. It's 2 minus what's in the parentheses. Don't distribute the 2. I would distribute the 2 if 2 is multiplied by the parentheses, which it is not. If it were, instead of 2 minus, it was negative 2, well, then that is way different, right? That's a different story. That'd be negative 2 times the parentheses. In this case, the only thing that's multiplied by the parentheses is what? What is being multiplied by the parentheses? -1. And that's it. And once I distribute that -1, the distribution is done. So I have 2 minus 5x minus 3. Lots of people got this, at least in my first period class, and I assume it's going to be similar in the second period class. Probably even better than the first period class, because come on. You guys are better than them, right?
Yes.
Okay. Well, here's something else that I saw. Let's add 5x to both sides. That's a great idea. Cancels out this -5x and collects all the x's on one side. Sure. So I saw this a couple of times. Well, we were right, and then we went too far, and then now we're wrong. Right? On this side, what have I added?
5x.
On this side, what have I added?
5x.
10x. Yeah, exactly. I've added 10x. So I've not added the same thing on both sides. And I see where the reasoning is, like there's some x's and there's some x's, so they should be combined with like terms and all that kind of stuff. But the thing that you need to understand is this thing is a scale, right? Equal on both sides. If I do something unequally on one side, that throws everything out of whack. It makes this side heavier or lighter or whatever we're doing. In this case, if x is a positive number, it's making it heavier on this side than it was to start with. Here it was balanced, now it's off. So let's just back up, and now we're good. Now we're adding 5x to both sides. That's what we should have done in the first place. I could add the 5x to this -4x. I could add the 5x to the 2x. I could add the 2x and the -4x and then add the 5x. It doesn't matter. It's all going to be the same. 2x plus 3, -4x plus 5x is x plus 2 minus 3. Okay. I'll just go ahead and finish this at -1. and I'll show you something else in a second. 3x plus 3, 3x equals -4, x equals -4/3. But here's something else that would happen. Let's say I approach this a little bit differently and I combine like terms. So I get negative 2x, right, starting from here. Negative 2x plus 3 equals negative 1 minus 5x. Really common thing to do, collect the x's and the constants, collect the x's and the constants, and now we'll get x by itself. But here's what would happen a lot. I'll add 5x to both sides, that's a good idea. And I'll add 1 to both sides. Certainly I can do that, because I did the same thing to both sides. You need to be careful of what actually happens here. Let's do everything, combine like terms, all the way across and see what actually happens. We get negative 2x plus 5x is 3x. 3 plus 1 is 4. And if you made this mistake, you probably just stopped. And then maybe said 3x equals 4, 3x, like maybe x equals 4 thirds or something like that. But this isn't an equation. What's on the other side of this equation?
0.
Okay, still fine, still true, still equivalent to the original equation because we have still maintained doing the same thing on both sides. It's just that it's equal to 0. You can subtract 4 from both sides, divide by 3, you get negative 4 thirds. What people are probably trying to do in this situation is something more like this. Add 5x to both sides and subtract 3 from both sides. That way on this side I get 3x plus 0 equals negative 4 and no x's. That's probably what you're trying to do. Just think about that, be careful about that. When you do multiple things in one step, just make sure you do things that are okay, right? Do the same thing to both sides. And if that's what you're gonna do, make sure you do it, you actually do it. Just do what you hope happens. Okay? Good? Any questions about that? See what I'm saying? See mistakes that are happening? Huh? I'll just take it like that. All right, so this is a specific question from the quiz. Again, I can assume this is a safe assumption that the number one mistake in period one is the same as the number one mistake in period two. And that would be this. Trying to get rid of all the stuff that is like attached to I want to get rid of that stuff. So we'll divide by RT. Well, that's true. I can divide both sides by RT. It's just that even though you can do it, it is probably not as helpful as you were thinking it would be. Right?
Yeah.
Someone who divides by RT is probably thinking, and the rest of their work shows, they think that RT cancels RT. And that A over RT equals P plus P. I think that they have that, and they don't. Okay. In lots of different ways, they don't have that. Let's look at it this way. This is a fraction, right? Da-da-da stuff over stuff, that's a fraction. We had a whole section at the beginning of this year on, well, prerequisites. And a big part of that was simplifying fractions, particular fractions with a bunch of variables in there. And remember what I said, if RT cancels RT, here's what we have to be able to do. We have to be able to write it like this. RT divided by RT times simpler fraction, so that when I multiply these two fractions together, I get the original. Let's try and make that happen.
I know.
RT times RT, or sorry, RT times 1, gives you RT. Right? Now, RT times, well, it's, hopefully you can see we don't need to distribute it to a couple of things here in the numerator as we multiply by RT. If I put P right there, that works. RT times P is P times RT. It's just, you know, written in a different order. That's okay. Commutativity of multiplication. But here's the problem. RT times this, whatever fills in this blank, needs to give me P. How are we going to multiply RT times something and get P?
P over RT.
It would have to be P over RT. Which okay, that's true. I guess that's what we need to have over here. It's P over RT plus P over 1, so I don't need to write it over 1. That's what I actually would have. Okay. You could also look at it as, well, RT needs to divide P, and RT needs to divide by PRT. Well, P divided by RT, good. And then in the second fraction, the RT would cancel, so we get plus P. But here's the deal. Now we've done it correctly, and it's not as helpful as we thought it would be, right? I thought it was going to cancel the RTs, and I just have a couple of Ps, and there we go. It's no problem. But it didn't work out. So that's not something I would try and do. I would back that up. I would say, never mind, that didn't work out. Let's try something else. Here's something some people tried. Divide by RT. Well, it's true that PRT divided by RT is just P. But now we're making a completely different kind of mistake.
We need to divide everything.
Everything, both sides. When we say do the same thing to both sides, we mean both sides. This is part of the right side of the equation, isn't it? So it also needs to get divided by RT. And if you recognize that, we can go back to what I just talked about. Right? That one does not simplify the way you wish it would. So that's not going to work. Now, let me just remind you of something before Mitch maybe answers this question.
I know.
Okay. Let me just remind you. It is a common finishing move as we're solving for P or X or Y or whatever. Then we wind up getting P times something equals something over here. Blah, blah, blah over here. Doesn't really matter what it is. But we get down to the point where it's like 3P equals 5, right? Or 7P equals negative 12, right? Pretty common, almost last line of your equation solving. You know what I'm saying? And what do you do right after you have this? It's like your last step. Divide by what? Stuff. All that stuff. And you divide this side by all that stuff, and you have P equals blah over stuff. Right? Yes. It's solved. It's isolated. We got it. So now that's we're going to try and utilize that idea. We divide by the stuff that is multiplied by P. Now we have to figure out what stuff times P is the same as that. Let's say I have stuff times P. Let's say stuff times P equals A. I'm going to call on Mitch because his name was up a while ago.
So if you take 1 plus RT and then you have the P and you factor P into that, it would be P plus PRT.
Okay, I'll just retrain the word factor that you said for distribute.
Yeah.
If I distribute P there and there, oh, P times 1, what's P times 1?
P.
What's P times RT?
PRT.
PRT, right, P times RT. So if we distribute the P, we wind up getting P plus PRT, exactly the same. But now we have it like we were just talking about before down here where I said blah times P equals, or stuff times P equals blah. What did we do right after that, after we had stuff times P? Divide by the stuff. That works, and this is essentially 1 plus RT over 1 plus RT times P over 1, right? That is just like the product of those two fractions. And on this side, we would need to divide by the same thing, or do the same thing on both sides. So 1 plus RT divided by 1 plus RT is 1, so we wind up with P over 1 equals A over 1 plus RT. Right? That's a good move. Right? That's a good move. What do we call that move? Going from P plus PRT.
Distributed problem.
Yes. And also,
no.
The distributive property goes this way, right? From there to there. P times 1 is P times RT is PRT.
The grouping property.
We We can give it all sorts of names, right? It is kind of like in the family of the distributive property, right? It does kind of take advantage of the distributive property, because if I were to distribute it, it would go back to what it was. But calling it the distributive property would be a little confusing, because we're not from here to here, we're not distributing. From here to there, we're distributing. We're going backwards, right? So you might call it reverse distribution. That'd be a good name for it. Okay, you might call it grouping. Okay. Don't dwell too much on this, but you could call it combining like terms. Okay? Because these are both P terms, and you can add them together, and the thing that would be multiplied by P would be whatever 1 plus RT is. Whatever you call it, it's not that important. What it is actually called by most people is, like this move is called, like going from here to there, factoring out a P. Factoring out a P. Both have a factor of P, and I'm factoring out that factor of P. This way is distribution, which is really just multiplication. Multiplication, that's all distribution is. It's just the multiplication of something times a parenthesis. Just like, if I look at this, this way is multiplication, right? 3 times 5 is 15. 15 is 3 times 5, that's factorization. So that's what we've done. Here we factor out 3, here we factor out P. Or here we factor out 5. So it's just factoring. So keep that in mind. Have 2 terms, or 3 terms, or 4 terms, or 5 terms that all have a y, or you know, this one has a y, and a y, and a y, and a y, and y, or this one has a p, and a p, and a p, and a p. We factor it out so that if we were to distribute it back in, it would be the same. But once it's factored out, then we can divide by the parentheses. So let's try that out before we move on. Say like 2xy minus y equals 14. Okay, solve for y. We want to be clever, and we want to utilize this idea, something times y equals something, and divide by parentheses. Right? Divide by the parentheses, and the parentheses will cancel each other out, and y will be equal to whatever this is divided by the parentheses. So, is it possible? Can we write y so that it would come out the same if we distribute the y? 2x minus 1. Let's check it, just double check it. If I distribute the y, do I get 2xy? Y times 2x is 2xy. Good. Y times negative 1?
Negative y.
Exactly. Okay. And I haven't really done anything like that I need to do to both sides. I have just rewritten the left side. But here's the idea, right? That parentheses is 2x minus 1, so we're going to divide by 2x minus 1. This thing on the other side is 14. And we're going to divide by 2x minus 1 over here. Cancels itself out. On the other side, it's just 14 over 2x minus 1. Questions? Okay, so if you were one of those people that was doing things like divide both sides by RT, well, the RT will cancel here, but there's no RT to cancel with this term, so that you can't just cancel it in general for the whole fraction. Just remember, factor out, undistribute. Don't forget about it. Okay, so there's that. All right, I've drawn 2 lines. Are those 2 lines parallel?
No.
Why do you say no? So can we say no?
No. Maybe.
Okay, we can say maybe. Maybe, but I'm not sure.
We have no evidence.
Okay, good. We have no evidence. This is as good as no evidence. Okay? For one thing, if you take me literally, right? Like these are two literal lines, then I'm just lying just from the get-go, right? Are these two lines?
No.
Why not? What stops them from being lines?
They're
what?
Line segments.
They're arrows, they're line segments.
Well, alright. Let's put arrows on them.
Lines. No, I'm scared.
Okay, now they're lines.
Are they lines?
Parallel.
What? Take me literally.
Literally, no.
Why not?
Because they're not straight.
They're not straight, right? I drew them and they're pretty straight, but they're not exactly straight. Even if I get the line tool, where is it? Right there. Here's the line tool.
I don't trust it.
Hey. Okay. And I put arrows on it. Is that a line?
Yeah.
If the computer is accurate.
Right, if the computer is accurate, if the display we're using is accurate. Get up real close and get your eyes right next to the board.
It's not.
And what do you see?
Pixels.
Pixels, right? It's not even a line, it's like a really tiny staircase. tiny steps.
It's not. Why? It's not legit.
The point I'm getting at is a good point that was already made. And that's that these two lines, even though I may draw them really well, not evidence that they're parallel. You might cause someone to believe that they're parallel, but it's not proof. It's not evidence. Colin?
What's the proof that we need to know that they're parallel?
What is the proof that we need to know that they're parallel?
Well,
you have to
prove
slopes, right? We need to get down to actual, observable, measurable, meaning numbers, evidence, proof, that these two lines would have to always, or have to never intersect, ever. The only way to prove that is not with a graph. Graphs are not proof of that. They're tools useful for other things, but they are not proof that two things are parallel. Okay? Be like, a picture of a person in one place and a picture of somebody who looks just like that person in another place. Is that proof that the same person? No, they could be twins. It could be somebody who looks really similar. It could be, it's not proof, right? What would be proof? Like DNA would be proof. Right? That's measurable, quantifiable, something that's unique to each person. So the slope of this line, as far as parallelness or perpendicularness is concerned, the slope is the DNA of this line. Tells us exactly where it's headed, and if some other line is headed in the exact same direction at the exact same slantiness, then they're parallel. So we need to find the slopes. Slopes need to be the same, equal slopes, right? Parallel lines. That's what we need. That is exact proof that they're parallel. If you just draw two lines and they look parallel, even if I could draw an actual accurate graph, it's not even pixelated, that's not a problem, it's a perfect line somehow. I don't know how we would even draw a perfect line. And if we're being really persnickety about it, we couldn't even really draw a perfect line.
I bet I could.
Get out your best pen and your best ruler. This pen and this ruler are themselves made of atoms, and these atoms have spaces between them, you know? And so they're not actually perfectly straight. They're good enough, they look straight to the human eye, the naked eye.
I'll show you a straight line.
You zoom in far enough, you're gonna find imperfections. That's what I'm saying. So this graphing is not proof that they're parallel. Their slopes are proof.
And there you go.
And what about perpendicular lines?
What?
Perpendicular lines.
Are they only perpendicular if it's 90s or?
Yes, it has to be a 90 degree angle.
What if they're looking like they're 90?
If they're looking like they're 90, they just look like they're 90. Those two people look like each other. It doesn't mean that they're perpendicular.
Yeah.
You take that in the hallway, just keep saying nines out there. Okay. Degrees. Right? It looks like 90 degrees, but it may not be. It may not be. So how do we take their slopes are what? Not equal. That would mean that they're parallel. How do we show that the opposite reciprocals are? Opposite reciprocals. That's what they've got to be. Okay? And if they're exactly opposite reciprocals, then then we have perpendicular lines, right? Example, the first slope equals 3/4, so the second slope equals, if it's perpendicular,
-4/3.
It's -4/3, that's the same as -4 / +3, or +4 / -3. All of these are the same. And coincidentally, this is -3 / -4 is the same as 3/4. So that those mistakes aren't made.
So is there no such thing as a straight line?
Is there no such thing as an actual straight line?
Mm-hmm.
Not actually.
There's no such thing. The line is real.
What about the string theory? When one of the strings is straight, you know? The makers of atoms?
I don't know anything about strings. But an actual line, an actual perfect straight line, for one thing, a line has to go on forever. Everything in our universe is finite. Okay? At least that we can see, right? We can only see as far as light can come back and hit our eyes, you know what I'm saying? Right? The light has to come to our eye, and that's the farthest away thing that we can see, is the thing that is the farthest away but is emitting light or reflecting light that our eyes can see. So everything we know about our universe that is observable and countable is finite. There's nothing infinite. Even the number of particles in the known universe is some number that stops, right? Just some finite number. So for a line to be infinite, first, that can't even happen. It can't even actually happen. And then for it to be straight, what's it going to be made of? The only thing I know to make it out of is atoms and molecules and stuff, and atoms and molecules are not made out of straight lines. They are little things, right, that have bumps and edges. Yeah.
So if light travels in a straight line, and it goes through two wormholes, and then it would keep traveling since nothing would refract it in between them, that technically it would be infinite and straight.
It wouldn't quite be straight.
I know, it wouldn't be straight.
Is light even like...
light travels in a straight line, it's not IR.
If you can find a perfect light source that never loses energy to one side or the other, then you'll have something
worth
billions of dollars.
Well, when the wormhole is this big, and
it
goes...
it just can't happen.
Yeah, I
can. Alright, so, in case, like now we should know that we can't just graph lines and say they're perpendicular or parallel or neither. We can't, it's not enough. So we need to find their slopes. And when we find their slopes, when we find them correctly, we know that if we have a slope of 1/2 and a slope of 1/2, we got parallel lines. If we got a slope of 3/4 and a slope of -4/3, we got perpendicular lines. And if we don't have either of those things, we don't have either parallel or perpendicular lines. So now all it comes down to is, am I having trouble finding a slope?
Yeah.
So let's find the slope. 3, 5, 4. Okay. I'm gonna briefly remind you of how I convinced you that this always works. If I have two, it's not these 2 points, but if I have 2 points. This one has an x and a y. This one has an x and a y. But now we get confused, so we'll call this the first x and the first y, and this the second x and the second y. Now, if I want to know how far is it, say, from here to there horizontally, how far is it horizontally, then I can take this x value, which is just this distance, minus this x value, which is this distance, I subtract it, get rid of it, and whatever's left, that's the horizontal distance, right? That would be x2 minus x1. Well, that's the change in x. That's the run. That's the horizontal. That's the denominator of the slope. If I want to know the vertical change, we'll call this change in x, right? That's the run, that's the horizontal change, whatever you want to call it. This direction we call it delta y. That's the change in y. That's the rise. That's the vertical. So that would just be y2 minus y1. And even if one of those things is negative or multiple things are negative, then it still works out because once you subtract the negative, you're actually adding on, and so you'll get that total distance between those two points. So, and it doesn't matter which one you call 1 and 2, it's not going to make any difference.
Really?
It doesn't matter. As long as we get the order correct.
Did you pick the bigger one for y2?
I would, just
yeah.
so that it comes out positive, but it doesn't matter.
Question, like a word problem, you wouldn't know which one would go first.
You don't know which one goes first right now.
Yeah.
I mean, I haven't called one and the other. I could have written this one first and this one second, right? The order I wrote them in is arbitrary. Since you probably took 12 minus 5, I'm just going to go the other way and do 5 minus 12. And I'll show you that it doesn't make any difference. First, you should find 12 minus 5 over negative 4 minus 3, and then I'll show you how this is the same. 7 over negative 7?
So it's negative 1.
Did not mean that. Well, it doesn't matter. 5 minus 12? Okay, so 5 minus 12, that means I just need to come back and do 3 minus negative 4, right? If I do 5 minus 12, I don't want to do negative 4 minus 3. I'm getting things backwards. Okay. This is my second point. This is my first point. And my second point needs to have the x2 and the y2 exclusively, and this needs to have the x1 and the y1 exclusively. Well, 5 minus 12, 7, I guess. And 3 minus negative 4, that's another thing that I see. If you're supposed to subtract the negative 4, subtract a negative 4. Don't do 3 minus 4. Anyway, 3 minus negative 4 is 3 plus 4, that's 7. Okay? You got 7 minus, or 7 over negative 7, right? I got negative 7 over 7, instead of both negative 1. Or if we change this to 13, right? Let's just change that up a little bit. 13, now that's negative 8. Okay? So I get negative 8 over 7. If you change the order, you're going to get 8 over negative 7. But in both cases, we have a fraction that is negative. It's 8 sevenths, and it's negative. Negative 8 over 7, 8 over negative 7, so it's a negative number. Positive divided by negative, or negative divided by positive, still, it's negative.
So, you said it equals negative 1, like if it was 7 on top?
If it was 7 over negative 7, or negative 7 over positive 7, then yeah, both of those are negative.
So is that the y or the x?
Negative 1.
Those? Yeah, so you go down 1.
So that you can just write a negative 1 over 1, so that we get a rise over run. So you go down 1 over 1, down 1 to the right 1. Or make this positive, make this negative, up 1 and to the left 1. That's all I'm saying.
Yes, that, yeah.
Okay. Cool. If you're having trouble finding a slope correctly, there's not a whole lot I can do. You got the formula here. I told you it doesn't matter which one is which. It doesn't matter which one is point 0.1, which one is point 0.2. Just make sure you get them in the same order, right? What I mean by that is, if this is your point 0.2, and that's y2, that's x2. So that's where your y2 and x2 come from. These come from the same point, and these come from the other point. Once we're there, once we're doing that, I mean, we're finding slopes. Just takes practice, I guess. Still having trouble, so it's going to take practice. To make sure that you are subtracting a negative, that's what you're supposed to do, is to make sure you're not switching the x's and the y's, to make sure that you're not doing 5 minus 13 over negative 4 minus 3, right? Getting them out of order. It just takes practice. I'd be glad to help you practice if you want to come in and ask questions. All right. That does it for what I had to discuss about what I saw in the quiz. Okay? So we'll go on to something else, something new. Unless there's more questions, like you have any general questions about, I didn't get this about slopes, right? I don't understand this about graphs. So. Still feel free to jump in there with a question, but otherwise, you know, get your notes out.
Hold on,
go. Just subscribe.
Yeah.
So make sure you have your notes out. I think you already have your notes out. Get ready for our next discussion, which will be 1.6. We're talking about.
Is this building on graphing or something?
Well, if we get as far as I want to, it will. But before we can get there, we kind of got to start with the basics of what it means to. to have an inequality. So 1.6, that's where we are, talking about inequalities. If you think about it, the things that we've been dealing with so far, we could call them equalities. Equalities, right? We don't call them equalities, what do we call them?
Equations.
These equations can be functions that we can input and output things. So equations, not equalities. Okay? So inequalities we could also call inequations, right? That implies what?
They're not equal.
They're not equal. Like one side is not equal to the other side. There's another way to think of it, if we have a scale like this, okay? If this is an equation, right? Perfectly balanced, this needle is pointing straight down. If it's an inequality, then this side is bigger or this side is bigger. They're not equal. Okay? So an inequality would look like this, just slightly off. It could be, this side could be a lot, like a little bit greater, it could be a lot greater, it could be really, really much, much, much greater. Okay. Or there's some inequalities that also are like, well, if they're equal, that's all right, too. Right? Less than or equal to, greater than or equal to. Okay. So that's what an inequality is. So when we solve inequalities, we don't find out like, oh, y is 5. When I find out that it's okay if y is 5, or y could be 6 or 7 or 8 or 9 or anything that's bigger than some value, some number. Let's just talk about that. We'll go with x. X is bigger than 5. X is bigger than 5. Does that mean there's like some answer, some number for x that is the number that x is?
No.
No, there's not one number for x that x is. What x needs to be is any number that's bigger than 5.
5.1.
5.0001, and all the way up to a million, and a billion, and a trillion, and a quadrillion, and for infinity. It could be anything in that direction, right? So is that as clean a way to talk about x as there is with equations? With equations, we can say x is 5, and that is it. And x is just 5. But there's really no other way to convey what 5 is, or what x is, other than to maybe show you a picture of what x can be. Would be with a number line.
Well, the number line.
Right, and then we'll throw a zero there. Then we don't have to throw a zero on there. A lot of people do. You don't have to. There's no rule saying you have to put a zero there. I think you should put a zero somewhere. But the zero could be over here. It doesn't have to be smack in the middle. Okay, then we'll go over to 5, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's 5. And I want to show you that x can be anything that's bigger than 5, but not equal to 5. Bigger than 5 only.
Open circle.
We'll go to 5 and we will put an open circle. Right? You know, when we've been graphing things, we put points, filled in points. And that means that, like, this is a valid thing. Like, x can be this and y can be this. And here we have a not filled in circle, not filled in point. We're saying, like, get close to this, but don't actually ever get to 5, because then that'll make this false. And then x can be 6, it can be 7, it can be 8, it can be 9, it can be 5.5, it can be 5.1, it can be any of these. Right? So when we shade it in, we're just graphing all of those points. Right? Same as before, same as the graphs we've been doing. All of these points, anywhere along the shaded area really being just all of those points that x can be. So what about if x is greater than or equal to 5?
Close circle.
Close circle means 5 is also okay. The value 5 also works. If you plug 5 into that inequality, it will be true. Trueness is something we strive for in mathematics. So if we plug that in as true, that's good. What about if x plus 3 needs to be bigger than 7? X plus 3 needs to be bigger than 7. Then, I mean, just use the intuition. Intuition now. What would x have to be? 4?
At least
4
five.
Greater.
At least 5? At least 5? What
if
about 4.5?
Oh, yeah, I guess.
Okay, so not at least 5, right?
Greater.
Well, what do you say then? Like,
yeah.
You can't
greater
say 4.
So a statement like at least or this or more is not going to work, right?
Greater
greater than but not equal to 4. So that works.
Whoa.
Greater than but not equal to 4. Okay, so if x is 4, will that work?
No,
because what will happen then?
It'll be equal.
That would be equal to equal. So if 7 is greater than 7, that's not true. But if you go just a squeak past 4, just barely past 4 to the right, bigger than 4, then we'll be good. Right? 4.1 plus 3, that's 7.1, that's bigger than 7. Right? So as long as x is bigger than 4, so that's just using our intuition. Okay. Now algebraically, using our algebra skills, we can treat this thing just like an equation. Right? By that I mean, well, I can just subtract 3 from both sides. If x plus 3 needs to be bigger than 7, then x needs to be something that's 3 less than 7, right? Oh, it needs to be bigger than something that's 3 less than 7. So x needs to be, well, I already wrote it. X needs to be greater than but not equal to 4. So we can just do the same thing to both sides, just like we would with an equation. Which makes sense. Like, if I have a scale, where one side is off, And I want to make sure that as I move things around, I don't make it move at all. Like, I don't possibly make this side be bigger, right? I don't want that to happen. So if I want to make sure that this stays just like this, I need to make sure I do the same thing to both containers, just like with an equation. I'll make sure by doing the same thing to both sides that I don't throw it off of how it started. So still, even like an equation, even though we have an inequality, we still just do the same thing to both sides. With one caveat, with one exception, that would be if we multiply or divide by a negative on both sides. Okay, so if we multiply or divide by a negative on both sides, something has to happen. Something, we need to treat it a little differently. We'll work with that in a minute. I'm going to give you an inequality that I want you to solve, and it's not going to be that difficult. So throw that at you. 2/3 x plus 5. Is less than or equal to 13. So, like I said, the only exception to what I just said that we could treat this like an equation is if we were multiplying or dividing by a negative, which is not necessary in this case. We just treat it exactly like it were an equal sign rather than an inequality sign. Subtract 5 from both sides. 2/3 x is less than or equal to 8. And if this were an equation, what would I do to get x by itself? Times 3 over 2. 3 over 2. Okay. That cancels everything out there. We get 3 over 2 times 8 over 1. 2 cancels with 8. That's 4. 4 times 3 over 1 times 1.
I know there's like when you do a certain thing to the equation, it flips the.
That's the multiply and divide by negative.
It's a negative.
Mm-hmm. So let's look at that. Let's bring it up. Let's look at why it is when you multiply and divide by negative. We have to flip the sign around. Right? If it was pointed this way, it needs to be pointing this way. Kind of a weird thing. Seems like magic, and I don't want it to seem that. Let's start out with a really simple example where to get x by itself, we'd have to multiply by negative, divide by negative, whatever. So we have negative x is bigger than 4. So let's look at the number line. At the end of the story here, we're going to find out that we'll divide by a negative 1, and x will be less than negative 4, right? We divide by a negative 1, and we have to flip the sign around. Okay, let's see why that is. Let's go back to here. Well, this is saying that something is bigger than 4. Bigger than 4. Let's even see bigger than or equal to 4. Well, we're thinking about 4, right? If we think about 4, there's 0, 3, 4. And we're thinking about numbers that are equal to 4. We're thinking about numbers that are bigger than 4. Okay? But these aren't the numbers that we want x to be, right? That's what we want this to be. This thing, this negative x. Well, let's say that I want to wind up getting 5. Get 5. Okay. Well, I don't want x to be 5, right? If x is 5, then I get negative 5 is bigger than 4. That's not true. So what would I have to choose for x so that I actually wind up getting a positive 5? What would x have to be so that when I take the opposite of that, I get 5? Negative. So, way back here at negative or negative 5, if I choose negative 5 for x, let me maybe use some different colors, like I'll use red. Okay. If x is negative 5, then negative 5, or the opposite of x, is positive 5, right? And so this will be true. What about if I choose x to be negative 6? Is that going to work? Negative 6, I put it in there. Negative 6 is 6, which is bigger than 4. How about 4? Will that work? Negative 4? Negative 4, and there's the equal to is okay, so yeah. So what about negative 3? Is that going to work?
No.
No, negative 3 is not going to work, because negative 3, the opposite of negative 3, is 3, and that's not bigger than or equal to 4. So all of the values of x that actually work are this direction. All these guys that are actually less. Like we start out with negative x being bigger than or equal to 4, and what x needs to be is actually less than or equal to negative 4. Right? It's the opposite of x that needs to be bigger than 4 or equal to 4.
I don't understand that.
Understand what? Except that a negative is bigger, well, don't think of it as negative, but as the opposite of some number. The opposite of some number needs to be bigger than 4 or equal to 4. Well, for the opposite of something to be bigger than 4, that thing would have to be a negative number to start with. The opposite of negative 5 is bigger than 4. The opposite of negative 6 is bigger than 4, because the opposite of negative 6 is positive 6.
Right.
Opposite of, well, anything that I plug into x actually needs to come from 4 and, well, negative 4 and less than that. So then when I take the opposite of that, I actually wind up with a mirror image of that.
So like if you put it in your little thing up there to get the positive, like you bring it down and multiply it. Is that what you're saying?
I'll take this number, negative 6.5, right? Bring it in here, multiply by negative, and now it's positive 6.5. So I need to take x and let it be something from over here. The mirror image of what this is talking about, right? Okay, let me just show you something else real quick that kind of shows you that. Where x and 4 are right now, they're going to kind of wind up being on the opposite side. I'm just going to do this in a different way. Rather than divide by a negative 1, I'm just going to add x to both sides. What does that give me over here? Negative x plus x is what?
Zero.
Less than or equal to 4 plus x. I'm almost there. I just need x to be by itself, right? So how am I going to get rid of this 4? Subtract 4. And negative 4 is on the greater than side, and x is on the less than side. So now instead of switching the inequality sign, I've kind of switched where x and the number are. So just like another confirmation that if I'm going to just change the sign of x or divide by negative 1 or multiply by negative 1 and multiply the other side by negative 1, I'm going to need to reverse it. So if you were good on that and you knew that whenever you divide by a negative or multiply by a negative on both sides of an inequality, you switch the sign, then great, you'll be fine. If you were wondering why that is, hopefully you understand a little more why that is. Or at least you're convinced that by doing this, it verifies what you've always known. Let's take the difference between the words and or. Okay, is it possible for x to be less than or equal to 5 and, right, and is the important part, for x to be greater than or equal to -4.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, you're saying yes. Why are you saying yes? Like justify that.
I don't know.
Because there's
well,
a
just is this possible? Is it is this like a statement that makes sense?
Yeah.
Can you
do
equal to greater than or equal to?
Greater than or equal to -4.
So get anywhere in between.
-4 to 5 is greater than -4.
Let's
still less than.
Let's look at something else and ask if this is true, if this is possible. X is less than or equal to 3. Okay, so far so good. And x is greater than or equal to 6.
Greater than 6 or less?
No, that doesn't work.
Not
today.
Because
that means it'd be less than 3.
But couldn't it be
so
a negative
like,
one?
It needs to be like connected. Like
okay, so let's look at the graph right here. Let's say this is -4. 3, 2, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it could be 4, so we'll fill in that circle. It could be 5, fill in that circle. And it could be 0, 1, 2, 3, anything in between, anything here, any of these things. So anything in this shaded area, the shaded area really just being a bunch of points that x can be. That makes sense. X can be two things at once, right? It can be bigger than -4, let's choose it to be -1. Well, is that bigger than -4?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And at the same time, is -1 less than 5?
Yes.
Yeah, it is both
of
those things at the same
time.
Yeah. So if in doubt, you say?
Yeah.
If in doubt, graph it out, yeah.
Because then when you graph that one, it'll be on the outside.
Yes,
yeah,
so
sure.
Okay, so let's call this 3, and we'll fill it in. We'll call this 6, fill that in. 0 would be like right there. So x can be less than 3 or greater than 6. And so we should say what?
No.
4 is better. Because you can't pick a number here and say, okay, so x is 2. So x is 2. So that means that it's less than 3, all right, but it's 2 bigger than 6 at the same time. It's not. 2 is not bigger than 6. 2 is less than 6. Alright. So it's just a difference between and or. With an and compound inequality, we could do this. It's a little neater. Because you can see it fits between two values. So we could go like this. Kind of put all that information into less. That would be implying that x can be between -4 and 5. That it is bigger than 4 and less than 5. Or bigger than -4 and less than 5. If I write it like this, like, okay, so x has to be less than or equal to 3. It also has to be bigger than 6. Now, I don't know, I guess that kind of works. But then there's not really anything I can just plug in for x, right? You can't put 2 there. It only works for this side of it. I can't put it 7 there, it only works for this side of it. And it can only be this or that, like it only worked for this one or this one. Like it can't work for both of them. So to write it like this, this is probably not a good idea. Just like that, just do it like that. This or that. Let's say we have a compound inequality and we want to solve it. So I'll show you that. Keep in mind, this and compound inequality is just two inequalities. It's kind of squished into one expression, one statement. The statement would be -4 is less than or equal to x, which is less than or equal to 5. That's an English statement we could say that would convey the same information. Let's say that I have 2x plus 5. Less than or equal to 10, and on the smaller side we get -2. Well, if I want to solve this, basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this guy and make it look like this. The expression 2x plus 5 is between negative 2 and 10. So there's probably like a sweet spot for x, right? That x can be between here and there, which would make the expression 2x plus 5 between negative 2 and 10. And remember that this compound inequality is just two inequalities. So we're just solving two inequalities at the same time. If I were to solve both of, well, the two inequalities in this case would be negative 2 is less than or equal to 2x plus 5. The other one would be 2x plus 5 is less than or equal to 10. If I were to solve them at the same time, this is what I would wind up doing. Subtracting 5, right? On both sides of this inequality, right? And if I went over to the other inequality, I would be taking 5 away from both sides of this inequality. So
each
thing, because really what we have is both sides of this inequality and both sides of this inequality. It's just that because it's inequalities, we can just sandwich it.
Is it still balanced?
Yeah, in a sense it is. But it would be like two sets of scales, which I do have, but I don't have them built. So like we have one inequality and another inequality. This is the
and they would be the
in
same.
Between. They wouldn't be the same like this, let's see. This would be like 10.
Stay the same as where they started with. Because they're starting there, they all got taken away the same amount.
Right.
So they're all still where they're at, you're not
like right. They're not equal, but they're kind of like at the same angle. So, like that. So this is like 10, and this is like 2x plus 5, right? So in this case, 10 is the bigger and 2x plus 5 is the smaller, right?
Okay.
And if we have another set of scales, this could still be 2x plus 5. But if you imagine another set of scales that's like attached to this one, then it would also be in such a way that this side is heavier.
Okay.
Right? And this side is lighter. But this would be the lightest, and in the middle we have something, well, in the middle, and on the far side we have 10. Right?
Okay.
Two sets that we're messing around with all at the same time. So if we take something out of one, we'd actually mess with all three in the same way. Otherwise you're gonna throw it off. We'll subtract 5 everywhere, we get negative 7 less than or equal to 2x less than or equal to 5. Divide by 2. Negative 7 halves is less than or equal to x is less than or equal to positive 5 halves. If I were going to graph it, then I probably wouldn't write it in mixed numbers, but I would certainly think of it that way. If I were to graph it, negative 3.5, positive 2.5. I'm going to give you negative 5 plus that equal to 7 minus 3x. Which is solve that inequality, that compound inequality.
No.
All right, so I'm gonna start by subtracting 7. Get negative 12 less than or equal to negative 3x less than or equal to 0.
That's cool that they cancel. I like that. Like the 7s.
Oh, the 7 and the 7.
So
you get 0. 0 could be a useful thing to deal with.
It's still there.
Yeah.
It's an inequality.
So how do we get x by itself? Dividing by a negative, right? And an inequality, so we need to switch all of the signs, right? All two of them. So negative 12 divided by negative 3 is 4. That needs to be bigger than, greater than or equal to x, which then needs to be greater than or equal to 0. Even those compound inequalities, we need to switch the signs. And it is possible for 0 to be between 0 and 4, for x to be greater than 0 and less than 4. That's possible. If it winds up that x needs to be this or that, then you need to show that. If it doesn't make sense for x to be sandwiched between two values, then you need that. So that's inequalities, it's solving for inequalities. If you multiply, divide by negative on both sides, make sure you flip the sign. Graphing it, you know, open circle if it's not allowed to be equal to, closed circle if it can be equal to. Hold on, we're not going anywhere. We got 5 minutes. So now, you're going to get a sneak peek of how this relates to graphing. So 2.8 would be graphing linear inequalities. So, how at the beginning we said x is bigger than 5, I think. So x is bigger than 5. And the only way to show that, to like see what x could be, was to draw a number line and shade the parts that x could be. Right? Does that make sense?
No.
Okay. Well, if we are dealing with an inequality with two variables, y and x, then really graphing it is the only way to solve for it as well, the only way to show the solution. So let's say that y is less than or equal to 2/5 x minus 3. Let me back up. Don't need physically. Don't need for any of that.
I don't know how to graph it.
I'm interested in people who don't know how to graph it yet. Okay, investigating this with me. Alright. If I plug in something for x and something for y, I'll know it's a solution because this will be or. Well, okay, true, which means that they're either both sides are equal because of this, or this side is. Well, less than whatever this side is, yeah? Okay. Well, on the graph, this is really like two things, if you think about it. It's y is less than 2/5 x minus 3, and y is equal to 2/5 x minus 3. Right? Like, both of these things, it's okay. If it works in here, good. If it works there, also good. What does this graph look like?
The y-intercept is down slowly.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3.
And then it's up 2 over 5.
Up 2 over 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's just a line. Remember that a graph is an infinite number of points, right? So I just graphed an infinite number of points. And every point, let's say this point, which is 5, comma, negative 1. It's 5, comma, negative 1. If I put 5 in for x right there, if I put 5 right there, what will this come out to be? That'll come out to be negative 1, because that's a point on the graph, right?
Negative 1.
Yeah.
So I put 5 there, I should get negative 1. Do it yourself, you'll find it's true. So, 5, negative 1, is thumbs up, is a valid point. What about this point right there? We'll say it's 5, negative 2. Well, let's try it. 5, right? Put 5 there. If I put 5 there, what will I get?
Negative
2. No, I won't get negative 2. I'll still get negative 1.
It's 2.
And if I put negative 2 right there, will this be true?
No.
But would this be true?
Yes.
Yeah. It would be true. So this point works. What about this point? Do you think this point will work?
Yes.
Because its y value is less than negative 2, or less than, negative 1.
Yeah.
And any point down here below that will work.
Yes.
And any point you pick, any points below that will work. So all the points below all these points
will work.
Nice.
Sorry, Shay, don't think right and left. Don't think right and left. Think below and above. Because we're talking about y on this side, right? Y is vertical. It's up and down, not left and right.
What if it is an up and down line?
That's a good question. That equation would be x is equal to something. And it wouldn't even involve y.
Oh.
Where x is greater than something.